Recently, President Trump announced his withdrawal from the Paris Agreement on Climate Change. I am Tim Perfetta, the director of the Nicholas Institute here at Duke University. I'm here with my colleague, Brian Murray, the director of the Energy Initiative, to talk about the implications of this action by President Trump. Brian, would you like to offer any thoughts on the top on what this means?
Sure, Tim. Thank you. I think I'm going to sort of hit on two points here. I want to explain briefly what the scientific rationale is behind the Paris Accord, and then talk a little bit about the policy mechanism that comes out of it. The scientific rationale is that there's been a long-term accumulation of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere that has basically been a result of industrialization and energy use that has accumulated and that is causing a climate threat. This has been long recognized in the scientific community that it's the accumulation of greenhouse gases that's causing this problem, which means that as a society, if we want to address the problem, we have to figure out ways to reduce the greenhouse gases. About 20-some-odd years ago, the UN came together and formed what's called the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change and says we have to figure out what to do about anthropogenic climate change. And where that process has led is to the Paris Agreement, which was an agreement by 195 countries to take actions to reduce the emissions of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. The United States is the world's largest economy and the second largest emitter of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. By stepping aside from the Paris Agreement and the commitments thereof, that leaves a significant hole in global efforts to reduce greenhouse gases and climate change risks. So, Tim, I guess one question might be then, with that in mind, what does this mean for the Trump administration and with policy efforts in Washington and other parts of the United States in terms of how we're going to address this climate problem?
Thanks, Brian. To some degree, this means a lot, and to some degree, it means a little. I think that it was clear from the Trump administration's policies already that they were going to roll back many of the things the Obama administration had put in place to meet the targets of the Paris Accord. So there may not be much of a change in terms of what the policy on the ground will be. But it does leave that hole in the Paris Agreement of the United States, the second largest emitter. And also, it removes U.S.'s global leadership on this global problem. For the first time, really, in our generation, the U.S. is not going to be part of the design of a solution to a great global problem like this, and for our businesses, not part of the design of the markets that will be created as we move towards cleaner technologies. It also is the loss of some of the structure that the Paris Agreement put in place to address this issue. As you said, there's 195 nations that are part of the agreement. Each came forward with what they thought they could do to make reductions. But the key of the Paris Agreement was the universal participation. Everybody made a commitment, and then there was a check-in and adjustment process to allow the nations to get down the path to where we need to go in our greenhouse gas emissions.
Tim, I think what was important about that is how we got to Paris is that the predecessor agreement to Paris, the Kyoto Protocol, did not have universal participation, and it was really considered dead on arrival in Washington that we would be able to advance something that didn't have universal participation. So the Paris Accord itself was really designed with Washington in mind, and that's sort of almost the ironic part about this. Would you agree?
No, absolutely. In fact, you think of India and China. Throughout our political debate on climate change, we've always looked at India and China, whether they will have to move in step with us or whether we have to move first. Well, in Paris, India and China took strides to make reductions themselves and sort of tried to take that issue away from the political debate in Washington. But nonetheless, the United States is stepping away. The last thing I want to ask is sort of the question about how durable a change this is for the United States. This is an issue that is very politically volatile in the United States. We seem to swing back and forth between taking action on climate change and not. And there's really a question whether this is a change that lasts past the Trump presidency. In fact, the steps that the United States has to take to withdraw slates the United States to officially withdraw right at the election in 2020. So the one thing I think we do know is this issue has now been put firmly on the ballot for our next presidential election.
Well, Tim, we've talked about durability, and that really brings up the issue about what the mission is at Duke for trying to advance an accessible, affordable, reliable, and clean energy system. And that mission is completely undeterred by what has happened recently in the White House and the declaration of this administration. We will continue to educate tomorrow's leaders to conduct and support cutting-edge research in low-carbon and climate-friendly technologies, and to engage with policymakers in the public and private sector to try to advance those solutions moving forward. I think we remain undeterred from that.
Absolutely. And thank you, Brian, for taking the time to talk with us about this with me today.
Okay, thank you.
Cheers.